Well, welcome back, everyone. I know you'll be disappointed for me to announce that this is our last panel of the day, but it's a great deal of fun. This panel is quite distinguished. The topic of the panel is policy making in action, and our moderator is David Brady. David Brady is the Bowen H. and Janice Arthur McCoy Professor of Political Science in the Stanford Graduate School of Business and the Davies Family Senior Fellow at the Hoover Institution. Dave has been on the continual appointment at Stanford University since 1986, serving as Associate Dean for Academic Affairs in the Graduate School of Business and as a Vice Provost for Distance Learning. Please join me in welcoming Dave and our distinguished panelists.
So it's a honor for me to be on this panel, chair of the panel on George Shultz's 95th birthday anniversary. Now, I have on two occasions heard George use Robert Frost's poem about roads diverging in a wood to make a very classy introduction. And the site he talks to is two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. And that path was one of great service to the nation through exemplary public service, and all the members of this panel also represent that. But I was thinking, so how could I, pardon for me, how could I come up with a classy introduction? And I thought the choice that the path they all took was quite long ago, so I was thinking about, is there something that's more relevant and timely? And I think the answer is yes, and it comes from Alfred Lord Tennyson's poem, Ulysses. And so, as you know, Ulysses is returning home from his from the Trojan Wars through a long odyssey. And he gets back, and you might expect that he would rest on his laurels, take it easy, retire. But Tennyson puts himself in the place that that's not the case. Ulysses doesn't want to retire. He wants to keep going. He's not going to rest on his laurel. So Tennyson has Ulysses say, and I'm not going to do the whole poem. he has Ulysses say, "Come, my friends, 'tis not too late to seek a newer world, one in which we older, but still strong, go forward, to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield." Perfect iambic pentameter, and in addition, very representative of what I think about the panel and Mr. Shultz. So with that, that's, George, my attempt to be as classy as I can. So the panel is, as you know, quite distinguished, and I'm not going to introduce them since it's all in the book and you all know all of them. I did send them introductory question, and the question was, each of you has been a policymaker at very high levels of office. Perhaps you could begin by sharing some of your experiences and the lessons you learned, and I believe we'll go from my right to my from my right to my right.
From your right to your right.
I had to think about that.
That's like what Ronald Reagan said, whom George and I worked for so many years, when he was being accused of being a conservative ideologue mayor. He said, "Yeah, we're a conservative administration. Sometimes our right hand doesn't know what our far right hand is doing." But I want to begin by echoing what you said about how delightful it is to be here on George Shultz's 95th birthday, because George Shultz is my role model. He's my mentor, in fact. George Shultz went to Princeton, so I went to Princeton. George Shultz went in the Marine Corps, so I went in the Marine Corps. George Shultz became Secretary of the Treasury, so I became Secretary of the Treasury. And then he became Secretary of State, so I became Secretary of State. Now, the one thing I haven't yet been able to do, as far as George being my role model, is be as alert and alive and involved at the age of 95 as George is. My only hope is I get to live to be 95, but it's a real pleasure to be here. Policymaking, I can't talk about policymaking, of course, from my own experience other than from the standpoint of making policy in the federal government. And there are a few things that come to mind. First of all, the importance of presidential leadership when you start talking about making policy in the federal government. Somebody told me once, you know, the president has a lot of cabinet officers. He's got czars. He's got all these important people, he or she, who advise him or her. But there's only one vote. At the end of the day, when it's time to make policy, only one person gets to vote, and that's the president. So without presidential leadership, you can't make policy very effectively. The second thing that I think about in terms of making policy at the federal level is that policymaking involves formulating the policy and implementing the policy. And it's in the implementation where we most fail, in my opinion. When you have an administration that's not real good about getting things done, not real good about converting their policy positions into concrete results, you have a failure of policymaking. One thing about Ronald Reagan and about George Bush 41, for whom I also worked for many years, was that both of these presidents knew that we judge our presidents on the basis of what they get accomplished. And so they were both anxious and willing and eager to get things accomplished. One thing that I think is really regrettable is that occasionally we will have people in high elective office who don't understand that that you acquire political power in order to get things done, and that you are, and you need to be willing to spend your political capital. How many times do you see, particularly at the federal level, a president of the United States unwilling to take a hard position or hard course because of the adverse impact upon their political capital? There are some other things that come to mind to me, one of which is the importance, in order, as far as getting things done, and that's the importance of teamwork. I think a lot about George Bush 41 in this regard, because here's a guy that spent a lot of time in foreign policy positions before he became President of the United States. He was ambassador to the United Nations. He was our first ambassador to China. He was head of the CIA. He knew how foreign policy was supposed to work, and he saw to it that in his administration it worked that way. And the first thing he did, and the best thing he did in my view, was that he made sure his national security apparatus functioned the way it was supposed to function. If you go back and read the history of administrations both before and after 41, you'll see that the rule generally was a lot of fighting and backbiting within the foreign policy community. Secretary of State doesn't agree with the Secretary of Defense or vice versa. Secretary of State and the National Security Advisor are at odds. Or some of the others are. What George Bush did was he selected a number of us who had served together in other iterations in prior administrations. He picked Colin Powell, for instance, to be head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. He picked me as Secretary of State, and I had served with Colin before. He picked Dick Cheney as Secretary of Defense. We had served together in prior administrations. And he picked Brent Scowcroft as his National Security Advisor. Brent had been the National Security Advisor to Gerry Ford. He knew the job almost better than anybody, and he was an extraordinarily able and effective National Security Advisor. George and I worked for a beautiful human being named Ronald Reagan for 8 years. And I worked for the first four as his White House Chief of Staff, and George worked for six years as Secretary of State. And by the way, we were very closely aligned in that administration. We were allies and colleagues, and we shared the same view, I think, of the Reagan presidency and what he wanted to get done and how we could best help him get it done. So I think about all those things when you talk about policymaking at the federal level. Of course, when you're talking about making policy for the United States of America, you're talking about making it in Washington, D.C. And there's a lot of difficulty in that. But it's really important, if you're going to get things done, that you understand the importance of bipartisanship. People, you know, used to knock Reagan as being this hardline conservative ideologue, which he wasn't. He was extraordinarily pragmatic. I was at his right hand for over 4 years, and I can't tell you how many times he would tell me, just the two of us in the Oval, "Jim, I'd rather get 80% of what I want than go over the cliff with my flag flying." And that was his view, and that's one of the reasons, in my opinion, that he got so much done. Semper Fi, Jim. I didn't see you walk in. But he got a hell of a lot done, and that was one reason. And he was actually very, very pragmatic. He understood that we judge our presidents on the basis of what they get accomplished. He was, he and George Bush the First were also very adroit and adept, I think, at recruiting good people, giving them responsibility, and then giving them the authority to carry out the responsibility. Holding them to it, but giving them the authority to do it. All of these things, I think, are involved in policy making at the federal level. But I keep getting back to this idea about implementation. Implementation is extraordinarily difficult. It's easy to stop things from being done in Washington. It's hard to get things done. So implementation is key. And one of the failures of the current administration, in my view, is that they don't implement very well. That's not saying they're not Republican administrations that don't implement very well either. There are. But implementation is really, really difficult. You got to formulate and you got to implement. And the implementation stuff is what's difficult. I was a lawyer before I went to Washington, and I came up through the political side. I must say that my experience in politics and in leading campaigns for president served me extraordinarily well responsibilities I had in terms of governing once I got there, and particularly with respect to negotiation. I'm sure George would agree with this when I say that negotiating for your country really is not a whole hell of a lot different than negotiating, for instance, as a lawyer on behalf of your client. I used to do mergers and acquisitions, and so I had a lot of experience sitting across the table from some guy, and I developed as a consequence of that some ideas about what's important in negotiation. And one of the first is, and Ronald Reagan, by the way, was so expert at this. He was a really good negotiator, and he really knew when to hold them and when to fold them. But one of the most important things in being a good negotiator, I think, is to understand the political constraints on your opponent or the guy that's across the table. If you do that going in, you got a better chance, in my opinion, of reaching some sort of agreement that might be acceptable to or beneficial to both sides. So understanding the constraints on your opponent, I think it's important in negotiating that you build trust, not that you sacrifice your country's principles in order to build a personal relationship with the guy across the table. You don't do that. But if you can have a position of trust with the fellow across the table or the woman across the table, then you're more likely to be able to get things done. George had that with Edward Shevardnadze, the foreign minister of the Soviet Union, and so did I. We both had a really close relationship with this extraordinarily adroit Soviet. And I never will forget George. I took him out to, you know, the Soviets were never allowed to go beyond 25 miles from their embassy in Washington or their UN office in New York. And so, and we used to have these ministerials where there was very, very formal, long tables, Russian, Soviet flags on one and American flags on the other. It was all very formal. And we thought, you know, we might be able to get more done if we take these, if we let the Soviets see something else of the United States of America. We took them out to Jackson Hole, Wyoming. And they were really impressed by it. It made it easy. The environment, it made things easier in terms of getting something done. So building a relationship of trust with the guy across the table is important. Timing, of course, is important in any negotiation pursuing and making policy. You got to know when to go and when not to go. I think of George H.W. Bush in that regard. We had a really very narrow window to unify the two Germanys after the Berlin Wall came down. It didn't last very long, and George Bush made the most of it, working with Helmut Kohl. And we unified Germany against the wishes of the Soviet Union, against the wishes of the United Kingdom, and against the wishes of France. They were worried that history would repeat itself. But here we'd been for 40 years talking about freedom and freedom for the captive nations of Central and Eastern Europe, foremost among which was the German Democratic Republic. And we had an opportunity, and George Bush seized it, and that's what I mean about timing. And the last element that I think is important in negotiating is pragmatism. Some in our party tend to say pragmatism is a dirty word. It means an abandonment of principle. Well, I would disagree with that fundamentally. Again, harking back to Ronald Reagan, nobody ever accused the Gipper of being squishy. And he was a pragmatist, and he was a pragmatist who wanted to get things done, and he got things done. I'm thinking about the INF treaty that happened on George's watch, and I'm thinking about tax reform that happened in 1986. I'm thinking about the Social Security compromise that we negotiated in 1983, where we put Social Security's financial status on a secure track for 30 years. And there are other examples, but pragmatism is also very important. Maybe I ought to stop there, David, and let somebody else pick up the baton.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Secretary Shultz, for the invitation to come participate in this weekend's activities involving the celebration of much of what you've done in terms of your career. And it's a delight to be on the same panel with these distinguished gentlemen. And it's always good to listen to Secretary Baker. Been doing that for years, and to hear him talk about how the public policy process takes place in Washington, D.C., obviously nobody back there has heard you.
They did before, but not this time. not now.
My perspective on the question of public policymaking will differ somewhat from Secretary Baker's, because all of my experience and my exposure, of course, has been at the state level for more than three decades, and then at the city level, which is a reverse of what happens in most of the lives of persons who seek and acquire public office. Let me roll backwards to the initial experience and exposure that I had to public office. It was 1964. I was elected on my second time trying. I lost the first time to an incumbent by 1,000 votes, and the day after I lost, I continued to walk the entire district because I clearly believed that I had not met enough people to win the election. And I was certain of that because in 2 years of walking post the first loss on 1964, I won by 4,000 votes in the same district against the same person, and it was because nobody had ever met him. And getting elected was turned out to be a much easier task than being sworn in and then having to make public policy, because I had none of the qualities or experience or exposure that Secretary Baker talked about. And I think I was a classic example of probably a majority of the people who get elected at the local level or to state office or and to local office. I absolutely had no clue, frankly, somebody from Dinuba or somebody from or one of the other small places in California, rural places in California. I had nothing in common with them. And as a matter of fact, we didn't even speak the same language. So how could I engage in public policymaking with that person when I said what were the problems in and about San Francisco on the first day out, or I had absolutely no takers, which meant in terms of pursuing public policy, the first lesson that I learned was, as a politician, person running for public office, hoping to be effective, you'd better develop the ability to listen. Not talk, but to listen. Because to the extent that you do listen, you can begin to pick up what might be a core of information that you might employ in helping to shape what you believe to be good public policy for the constituency you represent. Unlike representing the whole United States of America, you may represent only one small district. And that was the case of Willie Brown in San Francisco in 1964. Whether or not something happened in Fresno, or whether or not something happened in San Diego, or something that might happen in Los Angeles, was of secondary importance. The global view of the state of California was not my cup of tea and not where I was comfortable. And I suspect the other 79 members, if elected at the same time that I'd been elected, or they were pretty much of the same opinion. Fortunately for the state, only 10 people were elected with me, 5 Democrats and 5 Republicans. We suddenly discovered that the 10 of us had one thing in common. We were all without any information or any knowledge or any relationships with people or any clout whatsoever. We were all in the basement, so to speak, and we had to learn first to hook up with each other if we intended to translate and have an impact on public policy. After all, we had to learn, Secretary Baker, that out of the box, it takes 41 votes on the floor to impact public policy. It takes a majority of the votes in the committee to impact public policy. So suddenly, we were burdened with an absence of knowledge about the rules that apply to the public policy process. So not only did we have to learn to listen to others, we had to also develop the ability very quickly to grasp the rules and to, in fact, begin to utilize those rules in a manner consistent with what was the process by which policy would be made in the halls of the legislature. And it's interesting because on the first day, or first item that you have to vote on is who is going to be the leader, who is going to be the Speaker of the House. Well, Jess Unruh, a legendary figure in California politics, was the Speaker of the House. Jess Unruh had also been financing and had financed heavily my opponent for office, and he had spent a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of effort to try to defeat me. He had done the same with 4 or 5 other persons who had gotten elected with me. So the first vote I ever cast without any knowledge whatsoever of anybody else is when they said, he's nominated for the Speaker, and they got to me, and I said no. It was the first vote ever cast against Jess Unruh. Well, you're not going to affect policy if you end up on the wrong side of the issue where it's clearly personal. I was on the wrong side of the issue personally, and to show you how you quickly began to develop relationships, two other newcomers followed my vote. They just decided, can't let him do it by himself, and so they too became persona non grata with the House in every way after the very first vote. Well, Mr. Honorer set about to make the assignments. So suddenly, you got to worry at policy level in the state. If you want to make policy, you obviously have to be assigned to the appropriate policy-making committees. You have to be assigned to the committees that you care about and put in a person from San Francisco on the agricultural committee is kind of inconsistent with what might be the policy you want to have an impact on. Obviously, today, it would be a preference assignment because of pot and those kinds of things. You might want to be on the Ag Committee if you're from San Francisco. But in those days, the Ag Committee was something that we had no understanding about, but Jess Unruh selected committees of that nature to assign his persons who had challenged his right to be the leader. So suddenly, if you think in public policy, you're thinking in the interests of your constituency first, not the global state again, but in your constituency, you've already made what essentially is a misstep. You don't even realize you've made that misstep until suddenly you eat in lunch alone. Nobody else is having anything to do with you because you are toxic. You are not back where you need to be. So how do you begin to overcome that to affect public policy and impact public policy? You learn the rules, and then secondly, the subject matters. The subject matters that come before your committee are in the form of legislative proposals, and they come from individual members. Those legislative proposals have come from the drafting process in what's called the Ledge Counsel's office. It's come from the Office of Research in some cases, or it's come from some special interest group that has an idea that they think should be public policy for the state of California, and they are advocating exactly that. You'll find that in many cases, members of the legislature in those committees may not have read the measure and may not have done the research and reviewed all the materials surrounding the issue. So you quickly figure that if I got good grades when I was in college, or I got good grades when I was in law school, and I'm seated next to some person who does not read anything, who just kind of listens, you can become that person's brain if you're very careful to make sure you want to help them. You never mislead them, but you can certainly give them advice on where you think they should go on the public policy, and you do so by demonstrating how comprehensively prepared you are on every aspect of the issues. And it was always a good method by which to anticipate each side and anticipate it in such a way that there was no way anyone could really tell what you really desired. If you said, I want to tell you, this is what the opposition's going to say, this is what the support's going to say, this is what the administration is going to say, and these are the reasons why each of them are doing that. And if it proves to be accurate, overnight you begin to get the reputation of where people go to get the information that they need to ultimately make their decision. And you do not, under any circumstances, if you intend to affect public policy, ever allow yourself to be associated with the criticism of the individual who may take a position different on a given issue. You very carefully put yourself in a position where at all times you appear to be trying to make policy that will be reflective of good judgment for the House and for all of the people. Because ultimately, when you seek additional office or when you seek election or re-election, to the extent that you can clearly demonstrate the qualities that reflect how much influence you had on the rest of the membership by virtue of your acquisition of knowledge and understanding of the rules, you can begin to affect and impact public policy in a very dramatic way. And then you have to develop the ability to go beyond the framework of your own membership. As indicated by Secretary Baker, you really do have to begin to figure out where a person of a different political persuasion may be coming from if you want, at the state level, affect policy. For an example, well, it was very easy. Member of the Ag Committee, you're from San Francisco. Nobody in San Francisco will give a damn how you vote on ag issues. So suddenly, you begin to talk and begin to become a vote that can be relied upon by the ag world, because you have zero interest in what they are actually doing in those days. You know, you are not about vegan, and you are not about all the stuff that people now talk about from the ag world. You are not even about pesticides in those days. But you, so you had a luxury. You could literally be of assistance on an issue that with total immunity in your own district and in your own neighborhood and in your own constituency, to the extent you can establish that kind of role and that kind of role model, you become a very valuable and desired person on the individual committees that the leadership thought were deadly for you, and suddenly you become very influential in those committees. And you got to understand, as you go about trying to make public policy at that level, you're being watched, because you did the unthinkable. You said no to the leadership, and they began to watch, and they began, in some cases, to try to erect barriers for your ability to influence policy. And they will quickly conclude that it's probably better that they strike a bargain with you, because most of their people are not as studious. Most of their people don't have the necessity to be as dedicated as you have to be, because you established that problem for yourself. And under those circumstances, you really do begin to develop the skills and the techniques that will allow you to influence public policy far beyond anything that you started out with when you were first elected. You understood none of that in the process of getting elected, but you developed it as you rolled along. And one of the things that you'll find, without a doubt, the persons who've been there for a while will recognize very quickly some aspect of the talent that they think they can utilize. And when you've become a place to go for assistance from people who are your seniors and more experienced than you are, you begin to have a tremendous impact on public policy. And then you got to be very careful, because the debates that are involved on the floor, in the committee and on the floor, debates in the committee require at all times never ever or to be insulting to anybody, never ever to be humiliating with anybody. I recall that there was a debate on the question of a coastal bill, and it was a Coastal Control Act that had been voted upon by the people, but the implementation had to be done by the hall, by members of the legislature. And there was one member, a fellow named Alan Cerrone. He was really a pain, I mean, a real pain. And sometimes I'd lose my cool, and I suggested that Alan Cerrone's foundation appeared to be made of Jell-O. And you know, insult people like that, they don't forgive you. They don't forget it. And so at one point, when something was very key to me, he voted no because of the Jell-O insult. So you got to eliminate any possibility that you will engage in conduct that will take away from your ability to get at least neutrality from people like Alan Cerrone and under the circumstances. And so you learn that the hard way as you begin to develop all of the skills and begin to develop the relationship on public policy. And as time moves on with you in the halls of the legislature where you're trying to affect public policy, you for sure are going to come across people that you will try to figure out, how do I best influence them? I moved from being a backbencher very quickly or to something better than a backbencher, and it got that way because of, again, being a real student. On this occasion, when the next term came and they began to promote the newcomers, I was not one of the favorite person is promoted. Even though I had done all the things right by then, Honorable was still fearful that any power extended to me may very well be abused. And he was right. It potentially would be abused. And on this occasion, however, it served me well because he gave chairmanships or vice chairmanships and a subcommittee chairmanships to all of the other members of my gang of 10 of us from that particular class. And when he got to me, he had to do something. He just couldn't. Besides that, I was the only African-American, so I could use that if necessary to move the agenda and do it cleverly. Well, in this case, however, he assigned me to the representation committee chairmanship, and that is people who come before, lobbyists who come before the legislature. That's in the statute, representation, and it was a committee that had not functioned in years. No one had been given the assignment in years, and I don't know how he found it, but he found it, and he handed it off to me. Well, he obviously didn't read all of the provisions of it because it was a statutory chairmanship, not made up by House member rules. And it had said that, you promulgated the regulations of people who were lobbyists. Well, he was literally in love with the lobbyists. They were in love with him. They, too, had been on the wrong side in the efforts, my efforts to get elected there. And so I decided they were a shadow group, and what I would do as in that committee is I would require them to wear badges, and the badges would list below their name all the people they represented. Well, you know, every lobbyist in Capitol went nuts. They were not about to do that. I could not get a quorum for the meeting because Under put himself and the Speaker Pro Tem and the two Republican leaders. It's five members of the committee, the chairman, and four hostiles. And it was just absolutely horrible that he set it up that way. Well, I came up with the brilliant idea. Why not do one more thing? Call the committee meeting. I could do that under the rules. Call the committee meeting. And if no quorum showed up, have a subcommittee meeting and take up all the issues. And that's what I did. Only one meeting, because UNRRA called me up and said, listen, I don't want to have to spend nights and days trying to worry about what you're doing. So let you and I reach an accord, somewhat akin to what you did with the on the Berlin deal. I reached an accord with Jess Unruh in proper negotiations, and suddenly I was the chair of a significant committee that had a considerable amount of jurisdiction about who could be licensed to do anything in the state of California, including law and medicine and all the other things. It was all under my jurisdiction. Suddenly, I'm an important person. Suddenly, Jess Unruh had a level of, reduced anxiety, and I had a level of prestige that gave me the opportunity to really affect public policy, so much so that when Ronald Reagan became the governor of the state of California, by then, I had moved to a level of real public policy action. I was the chair of the Ways and Means Committee. And the chair of the Ways and Means Committee or the Finance Committee, one or the other, were either the one or the other would be the chair of the governor's budget or the author of the governor's budget or the vice chair of the governor's budget. Well, I became the chair of Ronald Reagan's budget. Can you imagine Willie Brown from San Francisco, the chair of Ronald Reagan's budget? Ronald Reagan was a smart guy. He had he set up the operation where he would invite the significant membership to his home for dinner. And I got invited to Reagan's home for dinner in my capacity. And during the course of the dinner, I discovered that Ronald Reagan, based on his conversation, had a basement downstairs that had trains, Lionel trains, all over the basement of his place. And I am a nut for trains. And so I started talking trains with him. I started talking the caboose and all those kinds of things. We ended up excluding almost everybody else at dinner. We ended up going downstairs, and they all went home, and Reagan and Brown stayed downstairs and really had a ball with the trains. And from that date on, public policy was tremendously affected by the contact and the relationship between Brown and Reagan. And that process continued for years, all the years that I was there, and it was the relationship that you talked about in terms of building a relationship that allows it to be translated and have a great impact on public policy. Through when George Duke Majan became governor, it was Katie barred the door with George, because he really was formerly a member of the House. He had had an occasion to operate with most of the members of the House. He had been the Attorney General, and incredible things occurred during that time period in terms of public policy, all generated by the ability to listen, the ability to acquire, understand the rules, the ability to understand the subject matter and the relationships. Where we did things like assault weapon ban, George Duke Majan. We did the business of research money for AIDS, George Duke Majan. I could go on and on to tell you that translating into public policy the relationships that have developed between the people, the acquisition of the knowledge, and the willingness at all times to share the table and to share the benefits and to share the glory represents how public policy is ultimately made. And most people seek in public office don't know that.
Thank you very much.
Michael. Mike.
Well, I'm enjoying this so much, I hate to interject. But I did want first to say happy birthday, George. Many happy returns. And I must say that what I know about public policy, I largely learned from George. I had the privilege of working for him for 5 years, and for that I'm very grateful. It's a little difficult to speak about public policy, and George's presence reminds one of the story I expect many of you have heard about the guy who survived the Johnstown flood. When he died and went to heaven, was told he could tell a story to the assembled heavenly host. He said, "I'd like to tell about the Johnstown flood." St. Peter was not impressed by this and tried to talk him out of it, but he was determined. The day came, and just before he began to speak, St. Peter said to him, "Just remember, Noah is here." And that's the way I feel. I didn't operate at quite the same level as Secretary Baker and Mayor Brown. I was down a step, although I did serve as for 5 days as acting Secretary of State, that is those 5 days after George returned to California and before Jim was confirmed by the Senate. I remember, you probably don't, that I didn't initiate any controversial new departures in policy. I didn't experience any crises. It was an inconsequential period, and I was reminded of this when a guy from American Enterprise Institute recalled sometime later that if a terrorist had attacked the inauguration ceremony of George H.W. Bush, I was fifth in line of succession. The other four might have gone by the boards. And what kind of appalling prospect is this for a guy who was never elected anything to be in the top chair? Well, I was appalled by that too, and of course was unaware of it at the time. I hope they've done something to fill that loophole, if there is one. I was introduced to policy making, I guess, when I went over to the NSC staff, and here I share an experience I know was valuable for George and for Jim. That is, while I worked primarily at State, I spent a couple of years at the NSC staff in the White House and 2 years in the Pentagon. And when it comes to policy coordination, it's a lot easier to go about that when you have some sense of the jurisdictional interests and the methods of thought and the people in those other agencies, and that was highly valuable to me. And when I went to the NSC staff in late 1976, just before Jimmy Carter came to office, I got my first experience in policymaking, and it wasn't a very happy one. Jimmy Carter had campaigned in 1976 to get all U.S. ground troops out of Korea. And when he came to the White House, I discovered that from others and from him, that he regarded campaign promises as sacred deals with the electorate, which he was determined to implement promptly and without a lot of second thought. One of my first assignments was to go over to Paris, pick up Vice President Mondale, accompany him to Tokyo to meet with Prime Minister Fukuda. And we envisaged this as a consultation, but when we were on the plane, Vice President Mondale showed me a personal instruction he had from the president. I've forgotten whether it was handwritten, but it probably was, which made very clear this was not a consultation. He wasn't asking the Japanese what they thought about the possibility of withdrawing troops. It was informing of his plan to proceed promptly with its implementation. Now, I got the job of drafting a proposal for an interagency review. But when it came out of the White House, the review was confined so it didn't address the advisability of troop withdrawals. It addressed only the modalities and the phasing of those withdrawals. Then we convened an NSC meeting promptly of all the principals, and what was most notable about it was that there were deep reservations by people at the cabinet level. I think the most vociferous opposition was expressed, in fact, by the Arms Control and Disarmament Agency head. But nonetheless, within a couple of days, the South Korean foreign minister came, and the president confirmed that he was going to carry out this withdrawal, and this was announced publicly following the meeting. So I think there were some serious flaws in the decision making. One was the review was too narrow in scope. One was allies weren't consulted but informed. Most consequentially, the withdrawal was to be unilaterally implemented without any conditions on what the North Koreans would do about the balance of forces. And the result of that was a very tough sell and very difficult selling this to the uniformed military, who in a way kind of fought it, as did many others, for 2.5 years until the policy was abandoned. In the meanwhile, we had carried out a pretty expensive compensation program for the South Koreans, and yet the withdrawals didn't take place. Pretty good deal for them. We had more troops in Korea in 1980 than we did in 1976. That was a big lesson to me. And people at my level, that is the assistant secretary level in the state defense, we organized almost immediately thereafter what we called a Monday informal, where the East Asia guys, the senior guys at the NSC, the Pentagon, State Department, and CIA got together every week. We were, I think, all experienced in Asia. We all were positioned in our agency where we could get a pretty quick reaction from our principal. We were pretty good personal friends, and we were willing to be quite candid about the thinking and the planning in our own agencies. The result was a lot better management, at least at our level, and so I think we served the principals, though we were at a lower level. And I think that was demonstrated by the fact this Monday informal meeting continued for at least 25 years, and for all I know, it may continue even today. The second thing I would note from my own experience was that I was primarily involved in the implementation, and to the extent my work was overseas, embassies are jobs in which the ambassador has the illusion of being in charge, but of course, policies are made in Washington, and you're mainly executing decisions made elsewhere. I found that the president gave me a letter which affirmed the authority of the ambassador over the country team. But in reality, when I got out to the post, you discovered there are three relationships that are extremely complicated. One is with the military commander, and we had big base complexes in the Philippines and Japan. One was with the station chief. We had big stations in both places. One was with the Treasury attaché. In each case, they had information that was very important, but they had incentives to withhold some of it from me. The military commander, because he didn't want the ambassador intruding into the chain of command, and he had a right to resist that. I wasn't in their chain of command. The station chief, because he was sensitive about sharing knowledge about sources and methods, but I needed to know about some of their people who I came regularly into contact with. And the Treasury attaché, because he had properly confidential conversations with the central bankers in the country about exchange rates and the value of the currency, and the ambassador didn't need to know, shouldn't know about that, but you didn't know what else was being transacted in those meetings. So I was able to manage these things, I believe, because of something I learned from George. he used to say that diplomacy is a lot like gardening. And if you want the plant to furnish, you gotta water it, you gotta weed it, you gotta fertilize it, you gotta accord a little tender loving care to it. And likewise in relations, if you want people to be there when you need help, you better devote a lot of attention to them when you don't need desperate help. And so I approach these relationships in that way, and I think it was a kind of admonition that was as valuable to me in dealing with my colleagues as it was in dealing with people in the host government. These relationships of trust, as has been said already, require a lot of tender loving care and a constant cultivation. That was valuable to me. On the embassy side, you only occasionally get a chance to really chip in on the policy. Shortly after I arrived out in Tokyo, I got a call from Carla Hills, great product of Stanford. She said, she was USTR, a trade representative at the time, and she was informing me that a new trade initiative was being launched. It was called by the awkward name of Structural Impediments Initiative and was basically aimed, targeted at the elements of Japan's economic structure that contributed to this huge persistent trade imbalance. And she told me about it in detail and asked me my reaction. And I said, I've only heard about this just now. I'd probably want to give it some thought. But the first thing that comes to my mind is there are a lot of Japanese senior officials who probably think that things in their economic structure are not items they wish to negotiate with foreign governments. And so the potential for a strong nationalist reaction is there. And just off the top of my head, it seems to me, you'll want to find ways of tempering that. One would be to structure the discussions in such a way that it's reciprocal. Japanese can raise complaints about our structure even as we're raising our complaints about theirs. And secondly, I've been here just a short time, but the striking thing to me is the number of proposals that are circulating around Tokyo about changing the economic structure. Professional economists, think tanks, the Mayakawa Commission had just come out with a big proposal, said to the extent you can, organize the agenda in such a way as to incorporate the items the Japanese are proposing reforms in, because then at least you can have some chance of getting domestic support for a proposal. I have no doubt there were people in Washington who already thought of these things, but they were a rarer chance to chip in on a policy as it was being launched. And finally, I'd just say one of the proudest accomplishments I have had was working with George under his leadership on the Philippine issue in helping Filipinos restore democracy and to the rule of law in that country. And it seemed to me in reflecting on that experience, there's something to be learned from that template which George guided. And it is that it's easier to manage democracy promotion. And we seem committed to this on a kind of global, almost promiscuous basis nowadays. It's helpful if the countries had some practical experience with government. They were restoring democracy, not creating it out of old cloth. It's helpful if the proponents of democracy and the opponents of existing government are people from the middle class, the professional class. It's helpful if there are domestic institutions, in this case the church, and some elements even within the military, who are supportive of those reforms. It's helpful if the attitude of the people in the country are positive toward us. We've had a relationship that counts for them. And it is helpful if our actions are supportive of local initiatives. They're relatively unobtrusive, but at key moments are decisive. And I think, thanks, as I say, to George's leadership, we managed that in the Philippines, can be proud not of having done it, but of having helped the Filipinos do it. We had a similar result, I think, in Korea. And since democracy promotion has become such a core element of our policy around the world, it seems to me when we call on other foreign leaders and say it's time to step down, we probably ought to spend a little time thinking about the templates that worked. And I think those in the Reagan administration did work, and they remain, I think, useful templates. I'm happy to stop there and resume the conversation, which I learned so much before.
Thank you. So I had a second question, but I think, given the time, we'll turn to the audience. We'll take questions from the audience, and if there's a little time remaining, we'll come back to the section. My question was, what's changed? George.
I was going to ask Willie, weren't you mayor once? Talk about being mayor now. That is the level of government closest to the people. So
that
it
is.
Always seemed to me there's something special about it for that reason.
Well, David was looking at me as if I was dominating and taking up too much time. And so I was following
just a little.
I was following his advice because what I wanted to do with reference to the local government job that I ultimately acquired, and I acquired that job, I would frankly still be in the legislature and I would probably still be speaker had there not been term limits imposed upon the state of California by direct vote of the people on the ballot measures. I'm a dedicated person to no initiatives on the ballot measure. But I'm not like the most popular person advocating in that position is not. So the voters said, after all the years that I've been in the legislature, in 6 years you're fired. And I looked around for something else to do. And the mayor's job seemed, at that time, partly open. I won that job with George's help, by the way. George, I think it's the first local official George ever endorsed. But he endorsed and came out and campaigned for me and helped elect me. I elected, and again, I'd taken a job where implementation of what we had done in the halls of the legislature was then, that was the responsibility. In the halls of the legislature, you implement nothing except the method by which you get the measure passed and the budget that will finance whatever needs to be financed. The actual operation of that occurs at the local level. And the business of government and for the people is best served at the local level through the implementation process. Well, having become a candidate for local government with the worst reputation in the world, frankly, at that time, for looking out for local government, I'd actually seriously considered on more than one occasion abolishing local government by way of the some of the people were so terrible in terms of what they were doing. Well, here I am, term limits. I want to still be in public life, and so I became the mayor of San Francisco, and suddenly I've got to live with what the legislature has opined and the Constitution of the State of California directs, and suddenly I am looking on a daily basis at the people who want government to be responsive to their needs. Having been in the legislature all those 3 decades or more, I frankly had no longer bothered to ask people what they wanted. I kind of figured out what they wanted by osmosis, I think, and proceed. But when you're in local government on a daily basis, you look at the people that you are supposed to be implementing the public policy for and implementing rules and regulations and the programs. And it was really difficult. Yes, I did win the job without any previous experience at local government. And on the first day there, they told me that they had a $90 million deficit. How can you have a deficit? So what do you mean, how can you have a deficit? I said, don't we estimate our income? They said, yes. And don't we report on what we believe to be our expenditures? Yes. How would those figures ever translate into a deficit? Up the income and lower the expenditures on the estimated. So we can't do that. Somebody else does that. And they gave me all these other people that were doing all these things at the local level. So suddenly here I am, not having the power and the authority, but having to be responsive to the demands of the people, whether it's the public transit system, whether it's the police department, the fire department, or the health department, the homeless issue, whether it's the streets and roads, whether it's the public parks, whether it's what the dog walkers can or cannot do in the public parks, what happens with the soccer fields, what happens with all of the kinds of things that people care about every day, whether it's the museums, it doesn't matter schools, whatever it is, in that capacity on the implementation side, you are on a daily basis challenged with doing that. And that really is far, you have to be far more inventive, far more creative, and far more burdened with rules and regulations that you don't universally control, period. And so in terms of the implementation of whatever the public policy happens to be, you have other elected officials who have an effect. For an example, the city attorney in most cities is in San Francisco, Los Angeles, city attorney's elected. Well, why would I use a lawyer that I didn't hire? Why would I bother with him? And here you are the mayor, and you got to check with the city attorney, who may be your next opponent. And there's no way he's going to be willing to help you implement the policy or devise a means by which the policy could be implemented. So first thing you have to do and should do is, under those kind of circumstances, devise a means by which to eliminate that particular individual from adversely affecting how you implement what needs to be done on behalf of people. You can't just totally ignore them, but you can move around them if you really become a student of the local government and the implementation. And my campaign had been, I can get the job done. No mayor before me had apparently done the job, according to what they said and what people said. And I, of course, announced, for an example, that I will fix Muni in 100 days. Well, that was 15 years ago. I didn't say which 100 days. Muni isn't fixed even today. And it's simply because you are troubled and challenged with employees and public employees with civil service protections and with union contracts or at the local level and with personnel processing that requires you to literally treat each one of those public employees as if they are a different country as you make the decisions about what you do with them. And so the challenge of implementing the public policy framed at the state level, at the national level, and at your own legislative level, at the local level, plus the apparatus of the structure that's there for individual cities, really makes it an incredible challenge to run cities and to implement what needs to be done on behalf of people. You really do have to be unusually creative. You have to be risk-taking, and you cannot even think of getting reelected by any decision you make, because the nature of the decisions you make on any given day could be just as deadly for ensuring your not being reelected as ensuring your reelection. And for those who at the local level try to make decisions based on reelection, they find themselves usually losing because they will be discounted by the citizens in a very dramatic way on the negative side. You really are better if the citizens get the idea that you are trying to make the best under the circumstances and you're willing to risk it all for that purpose. Whether you succeed or not, or whether they agree with you or not, they prefer, at least they do with me, they prefer and admire that course of conduct, George, at the local level, than they did some of the others that had preceded me and some of the ones that have followed me.
Thank you. Other questions? Another, George.
I'd like to ask Jim to comment on the terrorism issue. We have ISIS. We see that it can establish another headquarters, say in Libya. We see it can reach out to other cities. And what kind of a problem do you think this is, and what do you think we should be doing about it?
And well,
also it would be interesting to hear what a local city needs to worry about and how to go about that.
I think it's a real problem. It's not a new one. It's a much bigger one than it used to be, but you will remember that you and I went to Japan with President Reagan in 1987 at the Economic Summit, the summit of the major economic powers of the world, and we were supposed to be talking economic issues and dealing with economic issues, and the number one issue on our agenda was terrorism. 1987, you remember it. And so it was identified back then, but it's come on with a vengeance, and we have a real problem today, and we're not dealing with it. We could have dealt with it, I think, a couple of years ago when ISIS first started accumulating territory. My suggestion at that time, maybe it's a year and a half, maybe 2 years ago, was that we should have gone to the Turks. After all, they're a 60-year ally of the United States. They are a member of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. They've got a tremendous army. We should have gone to the Turks and to the Sunni Arab nations, Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Kuwait, Oman, they've got a big army too, others, and said, look, we the United States, together with our European allies, will supply the air, the logistics, and the intelligence for an operation to take this territory back. And I don't know why in the name of heck we didn't do it. I happen to think it would have been diplomatically doable, but we never, it didn't seem to me that we really made an effort to get it done. Maybe we did, and maybe we tried and couldn't get it done, but we should have done it. Now it's extraordinarily complicated, of course, by the fact that the Russians are in there and the Iranians are in there. But I happen to be one who believes that we need to be doing a lot more, that this is not going to go away. I'm not in favor of another broad-based ground operation in the Middle East. I happen to believe that we have shed entirely enough American blood in the sands of the Middle East, and I don't think we have to do it. I don't think we have to be there on the ground beyond more special ops forces, more air control, and that sort of thing. General Mattis and Gary would, of course, have a lot better view of that than I do, but I think we could have done something about it a couple of years ago or a year and a half ago that we're now it's going to be more difficult to do. I still think we ought to make the effort. But at some point, we're also going to have to figure out a way to defeat them on social media. We're going to have to defeat them in the clash of ideas, because they're not going to go away. And they're not going to moderate their behavior or anything like that just because we talk a good game. We need to do more than talk. We need to really get in there and get the job done. But I happen to be one who thinks we can do it without doing what we did in the first Gulf War, when we sent 500,000 Americans to the Middle East, to the Gulf. But of course, that was the way to get the job done efficiently and effectively and expeditiously, and we did. This gives me an opportunity to say something I have said before, which is that I think if you want a textbook example of the way to fight a war, you look at the way President Bush 41 fought that first Gulf War. He told the world what he was going to do. He went out and got the world behind his effort to the tune of a resolution in the UN Security Council authorizing the use of force against a member state. And then he got the Congress on board, which, by the way, one of the houses was dominated by the other party, and it wasn't easy to get him. But after he got the rest of the world, he could go to Congress and say, you know, Senator, you're not going to support the president in this action, but the president of Ethiopia is going to support him, and it made an impression. So he finally got the Congress behind it, went out and did exactly what he said he was going to do, and came home, and guess what? Got other countries to pay for it. It was the only war we fought that we haven't paid for. This is the way we ought to fight our wars. But more importantly, he did it decisively. He committed early on. It took political courage to do it. The country at the time was very much against the idea of doing that, but he did it. And we're going to have to do something similar with respect to ISIS, although I don't think we're going to have to put those kind of ground troops on the ground in order to get this done. If we have halfway capability of diplomacy anymore, and I'm not sure we do. I don't know whether we do or not. We didn't do this. I don't know why we didn't do it. But this formula was there for us to do a year and a half ago. I mean, a year and a half or 2 years ago.
Questions? Gary.
Mr. Secretary, you dealt a lot with Russia. Where should we go now?
Where should we go with Russia? Well, you know, you can't excuse rolling the tanks. I don't care what people say. I was last night at the event when Senator Bradley said what he said about the fact that we did not treat a defeated Russia the way we treated a defeated Japan and Germany in World War II. I give some credence to that. I believe that's true. I wrote an op-ed in 1993 in the New York Times that said, you know, NATO is a political alliance every bit as much as it is a defense alliance. And if the Russians will embrace democracy and free markets fully and effectively, then we ought to make a membership in NATO available to them. We took a half step. We formed something with the Germans called the North American Cooperation Council, I think. And they were members of that, and so were some of the other former Warsaw states. But nothing excuses what Putin is doing, has done, and is doing now, and continuing to chip away at Ukraine. And I think he understands that we're not going to be as resolute as we need to be in order to deal with it. At the time I was asked what I thought we ought to do, I said I thought we ought to send more forces to the Baltics for sure, and to Poland and the Czech Republic. And make it clear that this is not something that we think is acceptable in today's environment. It's not excusable for us to say, well, maybe we didn't treat a defeated enemy the way we should have. Maybe we should have let them come into the missile defense thing when we were building the missile defense for Poland and Czechoslovakia. And the Russians said, this is aimed against us. And we said, no, it isn't. It's aimed against Iran. And they said, oh, if that's the case, we'll pay our share. We'll pay our share of it. And we still said, no, you're not. So we pushed him. Doesn't excuse in any way what he's done. So we need to deal with it with strength and with resolve. We first need to get the Europeans to start ponying up the money to build up their NATO commitments, and we need to do the same in terms of rebuilding our defense establishment and our military. We need to do a little bit of what Ronald Reagan did in 1980 in the campaign, and then in the first eight years of his presidency. Peace through strength. We're strong. When we're strong, we can expect peace. When we're weak, we can't.
So my question is for Speaker Brown, Mayor Brown. That was such a virtuoso seminar on politics. And somebody mentioned this morning in a political context that Jess Unruh's sort of beginning the gerrymandering of districts made primary elections a bigger challenge for many politicians than the general election. Given what a diabolical strategist you obviously are, how should we work around that?
Well, we don't have that choice anymore. Under the governorship of Arnold Schwarzenegger, there was placed on the ballot a measure that changed the nature of the line drawing. I was a Picasso at line drawing. I consider that as much a part of my responsibility as Speaker as I did any other public policy making, because who was there to follow my recommendations would be determined by the line drawing. And so I really did the line drawn, and my abuse of that power may have prompted the attitude of the voters and the courts to take it away and create this independent commission made up of three kinds of people: see no evil, hear no evil, and speak no evil. Politically, period. You're supposed to never have done anything if you're going to serve on that commission, and they draw the lines. And then the second part of what occurred in that administration under Arnold's leadership was the business of eliminating party choices or substantially reducing political parties' participation in who the candidates would be. And so you now have this crazy system of primaries not settling anything. Nobody can win in a primary unless totally unopposed, period. Republicans, Democrats, doesn't matter. If there's only one name on the ballot, you can win in a primary. If there are two names on the ballot, it's two elections, one in June and one in November. And currently, it's the process produces some weird things. In many cases, it's two Democrats or two Republicans in the final election, which really substantially adversely impacts the choice of the voters, because you don't get real contrast and thrust and contrast and measurements of talent. You don't get any of that under those particular circumstances. So there is no need for anybody now to even think about line drawing. It doesn't matter. There's no reason for anybody ought to think about primary campaigns other than to be number one or number two, so that you can, in fact, get into the runoff, so to speak, on the fall election and try to get yourself elected at that time. It's made it far more expensive than ever before, and in particular for the political parties. Because when I served, I literally could bank X number of votes seat-wise for my reelection to speakership in June, and then I'd worry about the other five or six in November, and I could concentrate all of my time and energy and resources on those five or six. My Republican counterpart could do identical, because in some districts, a Democrat had no possibility of winning, particularly in places like Orange County, and obviously in South Central Los Angeles, a Republican had no possibility of winning. So it was just clear they were not there in the fall, and I was not in Orange County in the fall. And it was a very pleasant arrangement. I frankly don't know how these people get elected now with all this complicated process.
Can I say something about that?
Mr. Baker.
I understand what you're saying, Mayor. And yet I think about our political dysfunction today in this country, and I think a lot of it is due to redistricting, of course, which we have to do every 10 years. And if you're in a state today that's dominated by Democrats, more and more safe Democratic districts are drawn. And if you're a state dominated by Republicans, more and more safe Republican districts are drawn. And the middle is squeezed out. The middle in national American politics is gone away. We don't have it anymore. Now, it's not just redistricting that does this. There are other reasons as well. Number one, we are so evenly divided as a nation between blue states and red states. It's pretty evenly divided. This contributes to it. And then the fact, too, that the media today are no longer dispassionate observers and reporters of what's going on. They're players. They're absolute players. You tune in to Fox News, you'd know you were listening to the House organ of the Republican Party. You tune in to MSNBC, you'd know equally well you're listening to the House organ of the Democratic Party. And these things, all of this is difficult. One, it's going to be pretty hard to correct any of it, because the media thing you can't touch, freedom of speech and the press. The redistricting is constitutional. California has done something that makes a very adverse impact on local political candidates, perhaps. But it's taken redistricting out of the hands of the politicians. And Louisiana has done a little bit of the same thing. There may be something in that if other
if other states do it, that would eliminate this business of safe district drawing that has squeezed the middle out of our national political debate. But I happen to think that our political dysfunction at the national level, where nobody sits down and talks and works things out anymore the way the mayor talked about it when he was in the legislature and when he was speaker, the way we used to do it when George and I were up there in Washington, where you'd reach across the aisle and with both President Reagan and President Bush, and you'd get things done by shaving a little here and giving a little there. We don't do that anymore. And compromise has become a dirty word in D.C., particularly among some in my party. And that's regrettable, because that's not the way you get the nation's business done.
Mr. Secretary, I'd also say, added to your comment, would be that people who are well-prepared, a Stanford graduate does not include as one of his or her options running for public office. No. That just doesn't happen anymore. At one time, running for public office was considered an incredible honor and a duty. And so the talent inside of the halls of the persons who are making public policy today is much less on the positive side than it was 15 to 20 years ago. And that contributes substantially to the dysfunctioning that is the experience that we all are exposed to currently, because you've got C students holding office.
Mayor, I've only run for office once in my life, and I lost, and fortunately I lost, or I might have been stuck down in Austin, Texas, never had a chance to go to Washington. But I ran for Attorney General of Texas back in 1978. In those days, Texas was a solidly Democratic state, every bit as solidly Democratic then as it is Republican today. And I never will forget one time in a little town up in Lubbock, Texas, here's this Republican running statewide in Texas. I see some people at a shopping center, and I go over to give them some campaign literature. Now, bear in mind, I have been Jerry Ford's national chairman in his campaign against Jimmy Carter, so I'd gotten some visibility. I see some people there. I walk over to introduce myself to this guy. I stick out my hand to give him some campaign literature, and before I can say a word, he says, "Say, anybody ever tell you look like Jim Baker?" So I swelled up with pride. I said, "Of course, yes, they do often." He said, "Doesn't it piss you off?" True story. So I found out the best way to get to high office is to get appointed.
We'll take one last question back there. Although, as far as I'm concerned, you can go on until 6 o'clock.
This is a question for Secretary Baker and for Assistant Secretary Armacost. We had a conversation this morning on the Iran agreement, and I'd be interested in the perspective of both of you, both in terms of the process, which was, I mean, we certainly ended up in a very different place than where we started. So the process was long and arduous, a lot of statements made along the way that don't look as reasonable in hindsight, but I'd be interested in your perspective of both how the process was conducted and where we ended up.
Well, it's too bad in my view that we got ourselves to the point that we did when we had to decide whether to go forward or not. I'm hopeful that what the administration tells us will turn out to be true and that the Iranians will live up to the agreement, but I don't trust the Iranians. But having said all that, when the big debate began about whether we should go ahead and conclude the agreement or not, I think I agreed with the administration we should have concluded the agreement. Why? Because if we'd walked away from it, all of our European allies would have said, aha, the deal's going down because of the United States, therefore the sanctions are over as far as we're concerned. And we know from experience, Tom, that unilateral sanctions don't work.
They had to remain multilateral. That's what brought them to the table. So we were in a no-win position when the debate was, do we go forward or don't we go forward? And so my view at that time was we have to go forward, but it's regrettable, I think, in retrospect. I hope it's not really regrettable if Iran doesn't live up to the agreement that we got into the negotiation to begin with.
I don't disagree. The Russians and the Chinese would have been a huge problem, too.
Yeah.
So a lot really depends on how we keep the pressure on the Iranians now in the next 10 years and utilize that to keep pressure on them, not just on the nuclear issue, but in their conduct in the Middle East.
How do we ever accomplish verification?
Well, we're obliged to rely on our intelligence community by and large, and I can't assess how comprehensive it is. And I hope we would find some other means like the Stuxnet to throw some monkey wrenches into the process, too. But I think we're stuck with our intelligence, and that's added to the other countries' intelligence that have an interest in it.
I agree with Mike on that. I was given a classified briefing on the agreement and on the verification protocols. We have a lot of technical stuff in place at their sites that feeds us a lot of information. We do not have the right, which I would have hoped we would have gotten, for any place, anytime, anyhow, type inspections, physical inspections. We don't have that. But we do have a lot of technical means, stuff that's feeding us information all the time. And if that stuff goes down, of course, we could go to the IAEA and see what we can do about it. But,
we are a little over. I would like to thank Ambassador Armacost, Mayor Brown, Secretary Baker for being on the panel, and George Shultz for having the call to bring them here. And I wanted,
Dave, let me just
ask him the question.
We're moving on. I just want to thank all of you for coming today. Secretary Shultz, happy birthday again. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. There's a reception outside for those of you who can stay. Again, thank you and enjoy the weekend.